Wonderhussy here, out in the middle of nowhere again, but this time I'm in a town called Mina. This just in, I just talked to a local guy who told me it's actually pronounced Mina. But for reasons that will soon become apparent, I was initially under the impression that it was pronounced Mina. So please forgive my incorrect pronunciation for the first two-thirds of this video. Pretty sure it's pronounced Mina, not Mina. Because there's kind of, well, I did some research for once, and even though it was a really short Wikipedia entry, it was chock full of interesting information, beginning with the name. I guess there's kind of two theories on what this town is named after. One, it's named after the Spanish word for mine, because there's a ton of mining activity in this area. We're in Mineral County, Nevada, okay? It's a ton of minerals up here. It's like probably thousands of mines in the mountains all around this town. So the Spanish word for mine is Mina, so that's one theory. The other theory as to how it got its name is much more interesting. So apparently there was this Nicaraguan woman miner named Ferminia Saras. She was known as the Copper Queen. Okay, she was born in 1840 in Nicaragua to a sort of aristocratic Spanish family. And she ended up moving, well, long story, but she moved up to the United States with her husband sometime around 1867. And I don't think she stayed together with him for very long. They had like four or five kids together, but for whatever reason, they split up. And while she took off and started prospecting and mining on her own. Now, that was a pretty big deal back in those days. I mean, I guess it was a big enough deal that she actually wore pants when she went prospecting, which, hello, if you've ever tried mining or prospecting in a dress, it's probably not very easy, so what do they expect her to wear? But it was a scandal back in the day. I guess she was the talk of the town. I think she started out in the Virginia City area, but she ended up down here, which is sort of like, if you've never been to this part of the country, we're sort of, well, we're halfway between nowhere and nowhere. I mean, if I even tell you where we are, you probably won't know. Let's just suffice it to say we're about halfway between Vegas and Reno. But anyhow, back in like the 1870s, maybe, this Nicaraguan lady miner came down here and started mining, and apparently she bought up a lot of land and had some very successful mines in the area. I mean, this woman was fascinating. I can't believe I never really looked into her before. Really an interesting character. So she was a very successful miner, and she didn't trust banks though, so she insisted that everybody pay her in gold, and she kept all her gold in her chicken coop, because I guess she felt that chickens would make a lot of noise if anybody came in and tried to mess around with her gold. But the best thing I read about this woman, this is according to, I guess, one of her great-grandsons, which, by the way, she supposedly has a pretty big family still living to this day. I mean, I think she had four daughters and three sons, pretty big family. In fact, she put two of her youngest daughters, into an orphanage so that she could go prospecting and mining. That's pretty hardcore. So I can't really speak to her skills as a parent, but she does have a lot of descendants apparently to this day. And one of her great-grandsons says that she was very generous with her money, and you know, she would spend freely. So even though she'd make all this money up here mining, then she would go into San Francisco, which isn't exactly around the corner, you know, it's like, especially back then, several hundred miles from here, but she would go into San Francisco to these fine restaurants and order all the best food and the best wine and really live it up in high class until she ran out of money, and she'd go, oh, well, I guess it's time for me to go back out to the desert, go mine some more, make some more money. Fascinating character, and if you're interested in Nevada history or, you know, women's history or anything like that, I really suggest you look this woman up. Her name was Ferminia Saras. Anyway, like I said, the Wikipedia entry for this town is short, but action-packed. I mean, if you don't believe me, look up Mina, Nevada and read the Wikipedia entry. It's only like three paragraphs, but there's two crazy stories. One being the one that I just told you about, the lady miner. And the second one, there was a really notorious murder that went down here that ended up leading to the first ever execution by lethal gas in the United States. I didn't realize that the first ever execution by lethal gas was here in Nevada. So the story behind that is, apparently there was a Chinese laundry here back in the day. This Chinese guy I think it was like 74-year-old dude minding his business, running this Chinese laundry. Well, apparently back then, and I think even still today, there's a lot of Chinese gang activity. They call them tongs, T-O-N-G. A tong is sort of like a community center. I think the word actually means hall in Cantonese. So it refers to like this community hall where these people could hang out. Well, they inevitably became sort of organized crime hubs, I guess, these various tongs or halls in different parts of the country. So there was this one tong called, I think it was called the Bing Kong Tong. And this guy who ran the laundry here in Mina, Nevada, was affiliated with that tong. Well, they were beefing with this other tong called, it was either called the Hop Sing Tong or the Hip Sing Tong. I saw both on Wikipedia. I'm not sure which one's accurate. But whatever the case, the Hip or Hop Sing Tong was beefing with the Bing Tong Kong. And these two dudes came out, I guess from San Francisco, and killed this 74, 75-year-old laundry operator right here in this little mining town. Now, I guess a lot of this Chinese underworld criminal activity went uninvestigated and these murders kind of just went unsolved or unpunished most of the time. But for whatever reason, this murder here, they solved it. They figured out who did it. It was this 25-year-old kid from San Francisco. They caught him and tried him and found him guilty, and they were gonna put him to death by lethal gas. Like I said, it was gonna be the first ever execution by lethal gas in the United States. Supposedly it was a more humane method of killing someone than, I guess, by hanging them or by firing squad like they used to do. So it was a big deal. He was in prison in Carson City, and they went all the way down to LA to get this cyanide to poison him with. And that turned into a whole thing because they didn't actually have a gas chamber at the prison since they had never executed anybody by lethal gas before. There was no specially built gas chamber. So they went all the way down to LA, got this cyanide. I know I shouldn't be laughing, this is actually horrible. But they brought it up to the prison in Carson City and they tried to just pipe it directly into his cell while he was sleeping. I mean, this is really possibly cruel and unusual punishment. I don't know how you feel about this stuff, but they tried piping it into his cell, but there was too many leaks. So the gas got out and he didn't die. So they had to construct a separate gas chamber I guess there was like a butcher shop in the prison that was better sealed up. So they built this special gas chamber in there. And according to Wikipedia, they tested it out on at least one cat to make sure it worked. And then they brought him in there, and I think there was a big audience. They made sure there was a window so people could watch, and they put the cyanide gas in there and killed him in the friggin' butcher shop. That's Nevada for you. In fact, there was this quote in one of the big newspapers of the day, the San Jose Mercury News from California, that said something to the effect of, 100 years from now, Nevada will be referred to as a heathen commonwealth controlled by savages with only the outward symbols of civilization. Well, here it is, 100 years later, and you tell me, is that an apt description of Nevada or what? Anyway, all that happened back in the 1920s. The lethal gas execution was back in the 20s. The murder of the Chinese laundry guy was in, I think, 1921. The execution was in 1924. Fermina Salas died in 1915. I mean, this all happened a long time ago. And in the intervening century, well, not much of anything has been going on here in Mina. I mean, I've driven through this town, gosh, probably dozens of times on my way north-south in Nevada, and I've never stopped. I've never even driven around the back streets. So this is a good chance for Larry and I to just kind of cruise around and check stuff out, because it seems like a really interesting place. I mean, there's a sign out front on the highway that says you can buy a lot here, a piece of land, for as little as $2,000. I mean, I guess it's so cheap because it's way out in the middle of nowhere, and well, who wants to live out here? There's no work. Well, you know, now that the mines are booming again, I guess there is work. So who knows, maybe Mina will end up being one of those little towns that goes from boom to bust back to boom. I mean, right now you can see it's kind of a desolate little town. This is US 95 running right through the middle of town, and well, folks don't seem like they really want to stop. I mean, there's no reason to stop, I guess. There's no gas station here. I guess you could sort of call Mina, well, you can't really call it a ghost town because yeah, there's a lot of boarded up abandoned buildings, but I think there's still something like 150 people who live here. And I mean, you can see over there, there's a fire department. And up here, you can see there's a bar. So, you know, fire department and a bar sounds like a thriving town to me. This bar looks so interesting. If I had more time, I would totally go in and have a drink and talk to the locals. But first of all, I don't have the time. And second of all, it's like 2 o'clock in the afternoon on a Thursday, so I do not need to be going in and drinking. Okay, now, in my estimation, probably the most interesting thing about this town is this boat. And this thing has been here as long as I can remember. The first time I drove past it was probably like 10 years ago. And back then, I think it was a restaurant. You entered, well, it's closed off now, but you went up this little staircase. Sorry, it's kind of loud. I'm right on the highway. But you went up this little staircase and entered through those doors right into the side of this, oh, it's a sailboat? See if I can get a better view of it for you. And then it's a trip how they got all this old rope and this old pier out here. I mean, we are so far from any friggin' ocean. We're in the desert, dude, look. I mean, this view says it all. This yucca right next to the ass end of this old boat. I have no idea how this thing ended up out here. Like I said, I think it used to be a restaurant, and then for a little bit it became like a mineral and rock shop. Like, I remember my sister and I were cruising around once and we stopped in to take a look, and it was like gems and rocks and, well, kind of overpriced souvenir type stuff, so we didn't buy anything, and I can't imagine that too many people passing through here did. So it went out of business too, and now it looks like it's just sitting there closed. But oh, talk about a piece of property with potential. Right here with highway frontage and a beautiful view of the mountains. Imagine what you could turn this place into. Oh man. But it's interesting, there's all these really cool historic looking houses that are really well kept, you know, considering. So doesn't actually seem like that bad of a place to live. I mean, realistically, you're not that far from civilization. You know, I think it's maybe you're only like a half hour from Hawthorne, Nevada, which has like a Safeway grocery store and a McDonald's and gas station, casino, everything. And then back the other way, you're probably only an hour-ish from Tonopah, which also has a grocery store and a casino and gas stations. And then as far as like a Walmart or a big city, I think it's only maybe 2 hours to Fallon, Nevada, which is a pretty big town. And that's got everything you need, Home Depot, Walmart, you know, all the services, tire shops, garages. So even though you do seem pretty isolated out here, I guess relatively it's not that bad. Now, aside from the fixed up houses along the main highway, Mina was actually kind of a frustrating place to explore because most everything else in town looks abandoned, but there's no trespassing signs up on most of the buildings. And as I've learned in the past, just because a place looks abandoned doesn't mean someone's not still living in it. So unfortunately, I had to appreciate most of the ruins here from the outside only. Okay, wow, I just met a local guy here who has lived here for 14 years, and he was telling me all about this place. And first of all, the first mistake I made is it's not pronounced Mina, it's Mina. So remember that. I guess it rhymes with gold mina. But he was cool. He was telling me all about the interesting kinds of people that live here and well, I guess the town's kind of on the ups. I mean, he's lived here for 14 years and he said it was pretty busted when he moved here, but people have been cleaning things up, and according to him, there's talk that the railroad is even gonna come back through here, which would be a huge deal because this was a railroad town back in the day. And when I think the railroad went out of operation in like 1960, and that was probably a huge blow and partly why you see so many abandoned houses here. So if the railroad gets rebuilt, that'll be huge for this town. All right, so Larry and I decided that while we're here, we'll drive 10 miles farther up the 95 from Mina to the next little, well, town. It's even more of a ghost town than Mina. In fact, I think there's only about 30 people that live here. It's called Looning, and it's another town that I've driven through dozens of times and never really stopped. But there's a cemetery here, and it happens to be where the woman is buried that Mina is named after. Look, here's her grave. Here she is. Oh my gosh. I mean, I feel weird. It's a headstone, but there's no actual grave, so I don't know if I'm walking on it or not, but... Okay, so if the town is pronounced Mina, I guess her name was Ferminia. That doesn't really add up to me. If she was Spanish, it seems to me it would be Ferminia. What do I know, though? Whatever her name was, Ferminia Saras, she was the Nevada Copper Queen, born in 1840 in Nicaragua, died 1915 in Luning, Nevada. And she had 7 kids, Concheta, Concepcion, Juanita, Emma, James, Frank, and Frederick. And you can see that her last 3 kids were by somebody who was non-Hispanic. So that's her grave right there. Interesting lady. Definitely got to pay my respects here. From one interesting Nevada lady to another, I am here to salute you, Ferminia Saras. It sounds like it kind of sounds like a dinosaur. Ferminosaurus. I don't mean to be disrespectful. Cool lady, great history, and I'm glad I learned about her. Oh wait, Larry just pointed out that there's more on the backside of this little tomb. Ferminia Saras. Born in Nicaragua, immigrated to America in 1867. Although mining was a man's world, she became a prospector, venturing into the central Nevada desert alone, and developed into a highly successful woman miner. Her initial mining claims, the Amont and the Central America, were filed in 1888, and many more would follow. In 1902, Ferminia had the first of several major sales when investors bonded 25 of her copper claims at $8,000 each. In 1905, the railroad established a terminal in Soda Springs Valley, naming the town of Mina after Ferminia, Nevada's copper queen. Oh, it's a clamper thing. It's not even really her friggin' gravestone. Right? I mean, if the clampers put it up, that can't be her real headstone. Ugh, I feel like I've been had. Okay, well, I actually don't want to go looking around through the graveyard right now because I want to come back and do a whole separate dedicated video to this town. So I'm going to save this cemetery for that. But Larry went ahead in there and he's looking around for me just to see if he can find Ferminia or Ferminia's grave. Any luck, Larry? He said no. Oh, well, thanks for looking for me, Larry. I appreciate it.
No problem.
Larry, what do you say we go back over to Mina and I treat you to a late lunch at Socorro's Burger Hut?
Yes!
Are you kidding me? I gotta thank you for looking for this headstone for me.
No problem. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm hungry and that's supposed to be a really good Burger Hut, so let's check it out.
Really nice people, too. I talked to them for a while.
Oh, cool. Yeah. Socorro's Burger Hut is pretty much the only reason anyone stops in Mina. It's a tiny little roadside stand that has a 5-star rating on Yelp and Google. But astonishingly, I've never stopped there before. When I'm driving from Vegas to Reno, I usually stop to get Indian food at that deli in Fernley that I made a video about, which is only a couple more hours up the road. But sometimes you just feel like a burger. So it's high time I check this place out. I can't remember what the story is, why it's spelled S'Socorro's. I feel like it was a woman. I read an article about it online somewhere. This woman wanted to open a restaurant to feed all the miners in the area, and I think her last name was Socorro, but for whatever reason she put the S'Socorro in front of it just to stand out, as if being the only restaurant in a 100-mile radius wasn't enough to make you stand out. I don't know. Interesting, but like I said, it has really good reviews on Yelp and Google. And I've had friends that have eaten here, and it's supposed to be really, really solid, fresh, homemade food. It's not fast food, okay? Supposedly it takes a little bit longer for them to cook everything as they make it fresh, but also apparently it's worth the wait. Wow, this is one of those places where everybody puts their sticker on the window, look. Darn it, I don't have any of my stickers with me. Otherwise I'd leave one. Well, look at this guy. This guy's Baja bound. What does that say? SDHQ Off-Road Racing. Oh, look at this. The racing boobs. Look at this guy. Booyah. Oh yeah, I better look at the menu and figure out what I want to order. Here we go. I think I already know what I want though. I'm going with a... Ooh, I heard the Ortega burger was really good.
Oh no.
And some... Oh, I'm gonna have to get some fries. Oh, tater tots, yeah. And... a shake. All right, so there's a little seating area back here with some tables, but we wanted to find a sunny spot, so we're gonna eat on the old spool. And I got a strawberry shake and an Ortega burger and tater tots. Yum. Mmm. Delicious and worth the cold. This has been a long time coming. I have driven by this place dozens of times and never stopped. Mmm. Look at the burger. It looks pretty good. Mmm. Definitely worth waiting for. Probably took about 15 minutes to get the food ready, but during that 15 minutes, we had a great conversation with a local construction guy and learned all kinds of useful information. So it was time well spent. This burger is going to be awesome. I'm just going to pack it all down and remember for next time that when I'm passing through Mina, I'll remember two things. It's pronounced Mina, and this burger stand is awesome, so I don't think I'll ever be able to pass it up again. That Indian food in Fernley is so good, though. I guess I'm just going to have to eat both.